It is indeed I would say a proud moment for having the ADU program of the IGS prime time for the president of the IGS, Dr. Aman Mohan, for the year 2020-21. Being a digital man all through and is able to execute his presidency in the most challenging years of the IGS, or I would say most challenging year of the humanity in large. He's had a very unique opportunity, I would say unique difficulty was converted into an opportunity, making more initiatives, more opportunities well utilized at every point of time. Innovations were adopted on real-time basis and inputs were accredited and accepted on a real-time basis. And of course, plenty of initiatives and plenty of success which have been in spite of this difficult year. IGS prime time is one of his brainchild and initiative of 2020 new initiatives series, and I'm sure IGS prime time has been an ongoing success. We have seen stalwarts, we have seen giants, we have seen legends in the field of surgery, either domestic, national and international across the globe. It has been a lot of learning, both on technical side as well as on the personal side and the professional side. I'm sure IAGS, members at large, and of course the surgical fraternity have immensely benefited of the IGS prime time. On behalf of all of you, I thank our president, Dr. Aman Goel, our office bearers, Dr. Ishwarmurthy, secretary, Dr. Satyapriyo, treasurer, the president, Alex Sunil Papad, and the entire galaxy of the trustees, advisors, EC members, various false board conveners, I think I missed the vice presidents, and then to all the members who have been constantly guiding us to improve upon. And I'm sure we have done justice for this responsibility. Today's program is a very unique program where Dr. Ishwar and Madam Ishwar has spent a lot of time in creating, conceptualizing, curating, and they themselves are going to be the MCs for the evening for a wonderful session of this year. I have the privilege of inviting the Honorary Secretary, Dr. Ishwarmurthy sir, to take over the day's proceedings. Over to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Kanahavel. Good evening, senior colleagues, friends, and ladies and gentlemen. This is Dr. Ishwarmurthy bringing greetings from the IAGS office.
This is Mrs. Ramaprabha Ishwarmurthy signing in. Thank you for joining us in the special edition of Prime Time IAGS, which is tagged as Opportunity in the Midst of Adversity. Holy city of Madura is a birthplace of Lord Krishna only? No, it is a birthplace of Rama also. How? It is a birthplace of our beloved IAGS president, Dr. Aman Goel, who still stands to the statement of Albert Einstein, who says, in the middle of difficulty, there lies an opportunity.
We are going to have Professor Udvaria, Krishna Rao, Professor Srikante, David Lamento with us now, going to share all their views about the last 12 months. Let us welcome all of you. Please put our hands together to welcome the star of the show, Professor Dr. Aman Goel, our president, a pandemic president. Sir, I think the COVID-19 in the last 12 months, as you can see, put all of us behind the bars in our houses. Even the whole India, why not the whole world, was locked down, as you can see. But you had other ideas. You saw opportunities in the midst of adversity with so many exciting programs, starting from the COVID relief efforts, collaborating with the associations, webinars, master classes. Here is Udvaria.
Came into the presidency in a unique environment and a unique year. No other president has been tested as strongly as Raman has been tested, because each year it has been a gradual flow of the sequence of events going smoothly forward. This year, Raman, within a few weeks of his taking over, was smothered with the tremendous impact, the avalanche of the COVID pandemic. And I thought that this year we'd have hardly any activities. But Raman proved me completely wrong. We had more activities perhaps this year than we had before, because each activity has been so much more difficult to construct, so much more difficult to organize, that not only Raman, but the entire team of IIGS for this year has stood out as one of the greatest teams in terms of performance. To withstand and overcome this, not to be mentally impacted and staggered by this, not to be emotionally downcast, but to pick up the pieces and go forward in this year has been a remarkable feat of leadership and teamwork, and also, I may say, a great feat of response, responsibility, and acceptance by the entire membership of IIGS. So not only the leadership, but the entire membership has come out much better for this pandemic.
I'm sure, President, you would agree what Prof. Udvadia had to say. I think you had a very good, great chemistry with him. I want to learn from you, your relationship, and all the advices you got from the Padma Bhushan, our founder president, Prof. Udvadia. So over to our president.
Thank you. Thank you, Ishwar, and thank you, Dr. Kanagwal and Dr. Rama, for inviting me on this platform. I can't say it's a surprise. I was aware of this, but I didn't know this recording from this message from Dr. Udvadia. And I'm so glad that he spoke so positive about the whole year of that we built together. So I think as far as the advice and my relationship with Professor Udvadia is concerned, I think that evolved over a period of time. Before this year, we had very little interaction on a sporadic basis. But as the year evolved in last 10, 12 months, we became closer and more understanding. And I became very appreciative of his way of working. I have always respected him immensely throughout my life, because I know he is the man who has a vision and who has brought up IIGS in a very dynamic and a very ethical manner. He has given the direction to it. But this year has brought me so much closer to him and to understand him personally. So I have a lot of things to thank to COVID, and one of them is to bring me me closer to Dr. Udvadia and to help me understand him better.
I think he has a lot to say about you and our the last 12 months. This is just a little taste of what he had to say in the conversation we had recently. Let me just really want to take you to the day you actually were with me and Satyapriya on February 9th. I'm sure you even today will vividly remember that day when we colored what actually we were telling the whole EC, for that matter. We are all young, as you know, just to been elected the previous day. We were sitting, but we had a very busy 3 days. We were thinking, okay, that's enough. We want to go back home. We were about to pack and go for a very short, sweet welcome meeting. Usually, you know, the Sunday president meeting is just the customary meeting, but that was not the case in your, I'm sure you went on and on enthusiastically with the ideas that our 12 months is going to be system driven, it's going to be transparent, and we are all going to be accountable, and you're all going to be included. It was going, I think I can see a path is perfectly chiseled, not by a single day. I'm sure you have been incubating this moment for several months, if not years. I want to share your views. How long you've been thinking about IIGS? Please, over to you, President.
So, Ishwar, you are mentioning about the first executive committee meeting in Guwahati.
Yeah.
Where the incoming president has the first talk, and as this customary is a brief talk. But, you know, as a surgeon, I have always been trained to prepare in advance. I remember the time when occasionally I would drive Professor Shikhande, my mentor, from Shikhande Clinic to Bombay Hospital. and he has a major surgery, and he will switch off the music system of the car. He will open a book of anatomy, and throughout the drive of 40-45 minutes, he will revise his anatomy even at 60 years plus. And all these indirect impacts that had it on my mind, that this is a gentleman who is in practice for more than 35 years, but still before surgery, he's making sure that nothing goes wrong, that there are no surprises on the operation theater table. I think this is what has got imprinted. So when I got elected as president-elect, and this 1 year as president-elect is a very unique concept because it gives you time to prepare, I started thinking whatever I have observed in last few years in IAGS, what can be improved upon? And I came out with those thoughts in Guwahati. Some of them were rejected right there, like an online program and all. But we will talk about them later. So I think it was a well prepared presentation that day. I completely agree. But that is a part of being a surgeon. Yes.
Thank you. I think you rightly said. I think actually when we left Guwahati, we already drafted the program for the next 12 months. You know, but the COVID had other ideas, but you didn't stop. I think we went back to that drawing room there, along with you, Subhas Khanna, and the whole team. We were going all over the country to various government institutions, supplying them the needy, the PPE, all the masks, body bags, whatnot. And I think the more recent one with Zameer and Goindraj at Trichy, and more importantly, the Deep Goyal and the team with the Delhi, the Rotary Premier, I think they have gave a major contribution as a matching grant. All these things, I think it may look very simple. I know underneath you were toiling all day and night with all this team trying to make what was a dream as a reality. I want your thoughts on the cooperation and the winning formula you had in those three difficult months.
So I think right at the beginning, all my thoughts went for a toss when COVID struck. So sometime in mid-March, when our activities were supposed to start, the COVID came and we had lockdown, and everything was difficult to conceive. But immediately we realized that the physicians I knew, like in Mumbai, Kasturba Hospital was short of PPEs. The only hospital which was receiving COVID patients was short of PPEs. And though the overall impression that was given narrative was that things are being arranged, they are coming, but on a day-to-day basis, residents are feeling hampered. And I said, if this can happen in a metro city like Mumbai, this is probably happening all over the country. An association, which is not a part of the government, can avoid the bureaucratic hurdle and we can quickly deliver. And one of the major advantages we had, we are in every hospital as a surgeon. And we were not working because we were told not to work during, not to do surgeries. So we were resourceful people. We are a resource which are available in every hospital in across the country, and we could mobilize it. And I'm so glad you pointed it out. And I'd want to thank everybody personally, but my thanks to all of them. And it turned out well, and that was a big teamwork.
Thank you. I think it's still ongoing problem. I think we still, the war is on hand. We are facing it head on. I think IAGS continue to, persevere in our social responsibility. But I'm sure the more important thing as an association you keep telling is our accountability and also the academic responsibility. That's the thing. But we were thinking what all is because of the way you've been brought in. I think Rama has something to say.
16 is a worldwide as sweetest name, and you were the 16th and sweetest IAGS president since its inception 1987. Every president had set their bars high, and with their charismatic and commitment, they could accomplish. But this year was a very difficult year, but you motivated everyone and they came out all with flying colors. This fighting spirit of yours comes from your mother, who was a freedom fighter, and she has seeded this in you. Mothers are all walking miracles, like Edison's mother. Mary was the source of his invention, and like Putali Bai for Gandhi brought out his Mahatma Ji. And likewise, your mother seeded the heredity of healing touch in you and groomed you what you are now. Mr. President, we would like to know more about your mother and how did she influence your destiny? Over to you, President.
All right. That's a very sensitive issue you are raising. I was very close to my mother. I was the youngest child in the family, fourth among the brothers. And my mother was did her MSc Chemistry in 1948 from Holkar College, Indore. And she was a sports champion for the entire Holkar estate, which included part of Maharashtra and entire Madhya Pradesh. She would play badminton and cycle and all those things. And she hosted a national flag on Holkar College in 1942 during Quit India movement. So she was very active, and then she got married and she came to the Mathura with my father, and she was very active socially. And so even though she was not a doctor, all the patients, my father used to have an indoor of about 120 patients in those days. We had a tuberculosis hospital, and indoor treatment was the way of life. She would manage them single-handedly. My father was real aristocrat. My mother was grounded person. And so many times it happens that every patient was given food. There were no corporates those days. And so many times it happens that nobody's there for the staff disappears on a day, and my mother would single-handedly cook food for 120 patients three times a day. And so I had seen them, because we stayed in the campus, and I have been brought up seeing what is taking care of patients is. And the amount of pleasure my mother would get, you know, pleasure all of us would get, or respect that my family got from the, not only from the patients, but from the entire district. You know, I remember going as a child with her to, let's say, a temple or somewhere, and people will part way saying Mataji aayi hai, Mataji aayi hai. I mean, even a MLA or a MP would not get that kind of respect that my mother would get, and they will touch her feet. And this was an imprint that I had, that just by working well, people start respecting you. Even though she had no political post in the city, but still she had that kind of respect. This particular picture, she has my daughter in her arms immediately after she was born. Yeah.
Thank you. Very, very nicely said, President. It's emotional moments for you. I'm sure you are going to recollect those beautiful, memorable days as a schoolboy. And I could recognize you immediately, because the way you are looking, I don't think you are different. You may be 50 years ahead, but still, I think the face and the way, the style, the stature, everything, immediately, I didn't have even 1% doubt that's you. And you correctly said that's you are absolutely right. Then, of course, you grow as a college student and married and lucky to have Madhu Goyal. And again, Mata Guru is the next important person. I'm sure you had a very happy moments as a trainee surgeon under the leadership of this Dronacharya for several surgeons across the globe, the legendary surgeon in Mumbai, Professor Srikande. I was very fortunate to talk to him personally and also over the phone lately. And this is what he has to say about you as a trainer.
Now my age is 90. So what was the difference between me and Raman Goyal?
Yes, sir.
He came to me sometimes in 1993-94. And as you know him, the moment you saw him, you see a very handsome, tall man with a constant smile on his face. Normally, handsome people are not humility, but he was full of humility. And I found one thing, he was very inquisitive of what we were doing. He stayed with me for 2 years with my clinic, and he was so one thing. He has named her daughter by the name Treya.
Okay, yeah.
Because the name of my nursing home is Shreyas. So he has given name of my hospital to his daughter. But tell me, what more can they expect from your student? I asked him, what did you learn from me? Because this is a question I asked to all my students. He said, what did you learn from me? And he says, so your thinking, your analysis. Most people say, so your skill. But a great compliment for such a, you know, he is a thinker. Otherwise, we talk only about skills in life. I think he was very inquisitive. He was open-minded. To disagree with a pleasant space, ask for questions. And that makes a man a very different man. Can you believe when the COVID thing started here, he was the first and only one to tell me, hey, sir, COVID has come. Please take care of your health. Kamal, I am very proud of you for your achievements. I remember the first time you met me in 1993, I think. And I was impressed because you were very clear in what you wanted to do. You had pleasantness, and I have never seen you upset so well. Continue to inspire people. And how many people you train in life is more important, how the operation you have done in life. Anyway, surgeon's court, like the batsman court, I have bought so many runs from here. We have no reason to count the operation that we have done. How many people you are inspired in life? Right? I'm sure you will continue to inspire them in life. Keep good health, keep good traditions, and wish you all the best. Wish you and all your family all the best. Thank you.
I think that was Professor Veen, as you fondly call him. I think 30 years gone just like a dream. I'm sure you are standing so obediently along with the Kusal Mittal there. I want you to share the happy moments you had, and still you have a great relationship. Your chemistry with Veen, yes, please.
Okay, so this is a very unique chemistry. I was already a trained surgeon when I went to join him in a Shikhande clinic. Like a resident. So I was a resident in Shikhande clinic after I came back after my practice in five years. I had been to Mayo Clinic as a visiting consultant. I got trained in liver transplant in Europe and then came and worked with him in the clinic. And exactly what he's saying, I was observing more of his mannerisms, his way of talking to patients, his tissue handling, and when not to do the surgery. You know, so he would tell a patient who doesn't require a surgery that you don't deserve a surgery, you don't need to come to him, or don't go to any other surgeon, because if you go in a wrong place, somebody might operate you. And this was so emphatic that it's your social responsibility to a patient, not only to refuse, but to make sure that he doesn't get operated elsewhere, because surgery was not indicated. So I think there are thousands of things I have learned. I can have a whole day about my talk on my days at Shikhande Clinic, which would be, and there would be such pleasant moments. You know, occasionally he will, after a hard day of work, he will sit down for lunch in his room and he will call us, and he will have that one chapati and little vegetable or idlis from a nearby restaurant, Manish. And myself and Kushal Mittal, we were both residents together with him. We will both sit and he will keep talking to me, and he will ask us more. He will dig out more things. What did you learn today? What did you observe today? And I realized a good teacher is one who takes out the learning from the student and rectifies it, because you don't know what you have communicated, how the person has absorbed. So I think as you rightly mentioned that he is Dronacharya, occasionally I have told that I am like an Eklavya who has watched him from outside. And so because there are many people who have spent 5, 6, 8 years, I stayed with him for a very short time because I got appointed as an honorary assistant professor in Grand Medical College. And he only told me, Raman, now you are a professor, you should not be working like a resident with me. Please move on with life now. So I think I'm eternally grateful to him. And thank you, Ishwar, for getting Professor Shikhande on this program.
I think, as you rightly said, there is a lot of things he shared with me in a given time. He was so agile. And at 9 o'clock, I was talking the other day. And he was even telling, I think all of us youngsters, we are always in a hurry, as if you want to do a major surgery next day. He was telling, you have to wait for your turn. He said even after his qualification from Royal College, he came here 8 years. He was toiling in the streets of Mumbai, even operating, as you can say, in some railway stations, doing vasectomy. Then later he mastered himself as a reversal of vasectomy. Then only he went on to become the hepatobiliary surgeon. So everybody, I think that's the way. I am sure Professor Krishna Rao sir, who is joining us now, and also our founder, all will agree. I think the process of surgeon's career is always, it is like climbing the Everest. As you want to climb higher and higher, it's going to be more daunting task, but I'm sure the glory is there when you reach the top. But you should never say that you are already at the top, because there is always one way is going down. So you always start climbing. It is a journey, it is not a destination. That's what he rightly mentioned. I think you have the right persons in the right time. That's the reason I think you are what you are now, is because of your mother and also your guru and lot more. I'm sure Rama has something more to say to you.
Guru showed the way, but the journey was made very smooth and successful by your better half, Dr. Madhu Goyal. Dr. Madhu Goyal, by her profession, is a nutritionist, so she became a vital part in your profession. And our enriched character was for 30 years was a strong pillar for you, both in your personal and professional life. Dr. Madhu Goyal is a calm, composed, and a compassionate person. When we asked her about Dr. Raman Goyal, in her eyes, as a person, as a husband, and as a family person, hear what Dr. Madhu Goyal had got to tell us.
We have been together for the last 34 years. We may appear tough from outside, but from within, he is a gentle, caring, and emotional person who gets disturbed with irresponsible behavior. He can make any difficult task look very simple with proper planning and execution. He does any routine work in a different and interesting way, so there's never a dull moment with him. I would like to add that in the last 1 year, he's been breathing only IAGS. I am privileged to be his partner.
Doctor, President, I think we need your response for your best half, I should say, rather than a better half.
Okay, so we have been together for 34 years now, and I think we have been one of those few couples who have lived 24/7 together.
Yeah.
Because we work in the same hospital and we travel together to work and come back, and people say, my God, I mean, is that not too much? But you realize this is such a big boon. And it's not about the better half only, you know, the children also play a very important role, as you see on the picture. Which was taken in Jaipur when we went for one of the programs. My son Siddharth has played such an important role to model my life in last few years, because the youngsters are much ahead of us in life, in way of thinking and in way of taking their careers. And this 1 year IAGS, the COVID year, is probably there because of his inputs all the time. He has been working, he and his partner have been working from home for many years. So once I got grounded at home, which has never happened in my life ever, he was the one who said, this is the way you maintain your discipline, this is the way you exercise daily, this is the time you should spend on walking outside. And that helps in our productivity in the IAGS also. So thank you so much, Madhu, for all the kind words. I will record this and I'll show you whenever we have differences of opinion in future.
Multiple uses, like great human being, best husband, and a good dad too. We know that both of your children have come out in their life in a flying colors. We would like to talk to Dr. Shreya Goyal, who is doing her post-graduation in UK. When we asked her, fathers are role models and heroes for any daughters. For you, Dr. Shreya, Yes, your father set up very high standards and he had been successful in all his career. Did you find this as a pleasure or a pressure to come up to his standards, to be in par with him or to excel him? So let us fly quick to UK to see Dr. Shreya Goyal's response.
I think that's an incredible question, but I think for me, Papa has always been so much more than all his amazing achievements. He's been such an incredible father. I mean, you know Papa. Since I was a kid, Papa was the one who used to dress me for school. He's responsible for all our Sunday lunches, for all the cakes I got, irrespective of my marks after each exam or test. It didn't matter how busy he was, he's always been there for us emotionally and physically. But I do remember quite a lot about your professional journey. I remember when I was really small and you still only did sort of general laparoscopy and I think even urology. We used to go together on your evening rounds to Swastik nursing home and you always left me at the nurse's desk or sometimes in the car. And you were always late, but I still went each time because I loved the drives, I loved the time with you, and I loved hospitals. I remember later on when you started bariatric surgery, you used to do those public health meetings for obesity all over the city on Sundays. And there was always something wrong with the projector or the hall. And I used to be nicely reading my book in a corner, eating away, whilst there was mayhem going around me. I remember later, I think it was maybe in 2002, when you sort of were appointed to Bombay Hospital. And we all went for a drive to South Bombay at night, had some ice cream. And I remember thinking that, you know, I've never seen you more happy. And there can never be a better day. But I think there have been a lot of better days since. You've had an amazing career, continue to have an amazing career. And, you know, we've all kind of gone along for the ride. But I think sort of what's not changed is the person you are. You've always been so strong on what you think is right and what your beliefs are and encouraged us to do the same. You've always had an inherent sense of decency, which I've been really, really proud of. In terms of how that's affected me, obviously, I chose to do medicine, and a lot of that has got to do with you. I think if you were anyone else, it would be incredibly stressful to be your daughter. But because you're you, and I know that you see us for who we are, I know that I just need to keep trying to be a little bit better, keep pushing the envelope a little more, and hopefully one day you'll be really proud of me. So yeah, incredibly proud of you, Papa. Can't wait to see what you achieve next, because I know nothing and no one's going to stop you.
Dr. President, you have really personified and have imprinted the recipe of success in all of them. Very few words about your wonderful kids, President.
So, you know, Shreya has said that all. You know, when he said that he would go to the Swastik nursing home, she would go because there was a nice coffee machine there, which would give coffee those days. Coffee machines are very few and she would always have the coffee. She would make me promise that I'll get a coffee for her while she's waiting. And then going to Bombay Hospital was a dream because I have always seen Dr. Shrikhande there. And so I always thought that if I get attached to Bombay Hospital, I'll have no more ambition left after that. And fortunately, that came early because of bariatric surgery. Children have been a great, as I said, they have been very close to me. And I have left them to follow their way, you know. So Shreya was doing excellent in 8th standard in an ICSC school. And then by that time, the Dhirubhai Ambani school was started in Mumbai, which was an international school. And Shreya used to come first in her class and I shifted her to international school. Everybody said, you're crazy. She will not get admission in medicine in India. I said, I don't want her to run under tuitions for next 4 years. Let her enjoy these 4 years of life and we'll see what she takes after that. And I was proved right. Because we could get her into Leicester Medical School without any donations, without anything. and she continues there, and now she's on her own getting admission and post-graduation there. So I think if children are left to develop their own potential, they grow better than the rota system of education that we have in India. So I think I've already spoken to that. That's my son when he completed his master's in Colombia and in energy policy, and we went for his convocation. So I think it had been a great benefit to have such kids who excelled in their field. And I am already proud of both of them. I have always been proud. And I think children need not to prove themselves to be, you know, the parents to become proud. Anything, even if they get 40% marks, you should be proud of it, because a parent should be proud. And that is what I have maintained throughout. Luckily, they all did well in their education. That's a different part. But so I'm so happy that they are there. And parents have a phenomenal responsibility to play in the growth of their children.
Thank you. Thank you, Prasanna. That was the sweet memories of the family. Let us come to our IAGS Associate. I am sure you have been thinking about IAGS, breathing IAGS for the last 12 months. But I'm sure because of this COVID, we had a lot of trouble. But you see things differently. You saw every stumbling block as a turning point in life. And when I see that the glass is half empty, you see, it's already half full. Why you are worried? Then you are so optimistic in everything. When I say, okay, we are going to have an end of a road, but you see that just it's a bend in the road, just to keep going, you'll have the opportunities to knock at you. So there are various moments we can recall. Like, I'm sure there are three or four I want to see. One, of course, is the last 12 months. We had volumes of webinars, plenty of masterclasses, and the association with the various experts, the international platform, along with your IPP. I am sure you had a very great chemistry. I think he is something like an elder brother to you, Sayanda. I want your chemistry and how you are able to get along so well, able to contribute so much to our association.
Okay, that's a great question, because, you know, when you put a picture of Sayanda, people say you have friendship that carries on from your school days. Sayanda is probably closest to me in IIGS, because I have watched him so closely in the 3 to 4 years that we worked together as a team. And I have seen this man who stands for his belief, and the whole association or the whole top leadership was pushing him in another direction. He stood ground and he made sure that the right thing is done. So I have phenomenal respect for him. And that's why when it came to that, who should head the academic council, which is the most important activity of IAGS, I naturally chose Sayandev Das Gupta to head it. And then together and with you, we worked out all these activities. And these activities brought the enthusiasm in the association. And the activities happened because my thought was that IAGS has become a training and retraining institute association. But what about people like Dr. Ishwar Murthy or Dr. Kanak Bail or Dr. Sayandev, who are all well-trained surgeons? They don't feel excited about IAGS. So if we bring something which is at a higher level for them, like master classes or what we will probably talk about, research. So those are the things which excites a very well-trained surgeon to come on board. And I brought in together we thought about these collaborations with the neighboring countries. I have realized one thing. When we go to USA to attend a conference, we have surgeons from 80 countries participating. And I see India is in the same position as USA in terms of resources, in terms of trained manpower, in terms of everything, a political system which is democratic, which is an open country. I say, why we can't take this position for neighboring countries to support them, to accommodate them? And that's why when I was given a go-ahead in Guwahati to go ahead with this collaboration by the executive committee, I immediately approached these associations, and I'm very happy that Maldives, Bangladesh, and Pakistan immediately joined. And that brought a team which is going to work together for years together by exchange of knowledge and academic collaborations.
That's right, sir. In addition, I am sure we had a lot of experts because of this online program. All the experts we usually see once in a year when we go across to various countries. Now they were all on the platform and brought in every weekly basis. And all these people you see, they're all there in the platform of either from the Sages or Selsby or Elsa. Even Michelle Gagner was there and Barry Salke was there. And we were able to make a very good cordial relationship with Stages, Ipsis and Elsa. I think when I spoke to actually Elsa General Secretary David Lamento, and this is what he said from Singapore the other day.
It's a great honor for me to say thank you to Ramen. I think Elsa and IAGS friendship goes far beyond the two decades. I think since Urvadia, Professor Urvadia was one of the founders of both IAGS and Elsa. So just imagine, I think we are probably celebrate 30 years of friendship between the two big societies like IAGS and Elsa. Plus, we have a lot of friends during the year. And I'm especially for myself, it was a kind of special relation that I always have with all my Indian friends, from Pradeep, Professor Upadhyay. I call him always my mentor. I always ask him something, and we have a really special relation. And of course, great respect with Pradeep Chauvet, with the next president, Sunil Pobat, and many of you, Professor Krishna Rao, many, I think most of the members, I think I know them personally. And I also have an honorary membership of IAGS. That was my first honorary membership, and it gave me a great pleasure. With Ramen, we have a great friendship. I like Ramen because he's a very sincere, very good friends. He always direct, ask you something, and we always find a way to make both of us happy. He was very supportive since he became president, especially in the last year. And actually, thanks to him and his nice way to also demonstrate friendship and to handle and to manage the society, we were able to bring the World Congress in India after 30 years of, let's say, kind of unsuccessful attempt.
I think you nicely set the stage. For us, I think we are more confident. I think 12 months before was a lot different from what we are now. With so many people are now friendly, are looking forward wherever we go. I think they all realize that we are ready to host, and that's the challenge you took as an academic, I think, committee chairman. I think you set the stage for World Congress 2024. Your thoughts on that, President?
So thank you, David, for your kind words. The World Congress was brought to India by Dr. Subhash Khanna, as we all know, almost 2 years back. But there had been some irritants because of the COVID. The one country which lost out the World Congress wanted the same year. And as it happens, you need to play your cards well. Executive committee with you, doing the spade work, supported the way we wanted to approach the International Federation. And I'm happy that David looked through what IAGS wanted, what were our priority, and with Natan Zundel, the president of IFSIS, they all agreed, and the executive committee put entire faith in me that you approach them single-handedly and see how you can manage to get the conference somehow, because everybody thought India will be again denied this Congress in 24. And, once it came, it was really a major achievement for IAGS. And I'm so glad that we could all pull it together. And that is the strength of a teamwork when everybody puts their might together. And I'm so happy that David sees it that way. So thank you, Ishwar, for getting this confirmation from him.
Thank you.
your hunger for research and your passion to propagate the knowledge, and you wanted every surgeon to publish and flourish. So along with Dr. Ramesh Agarwala, the chairman of research committee, you initiated lots of research activities. One of the monumental tasks was the democratic and transparent selection of JMAS editorial board. And one more thing, first time in the life of IAGS, the inter-societies came up with the guidelines for COVID, and it was formulated and implemented for the first time in the JMAS as the original article. So thanks to you, thanks to IAGS, thanks to AMASI, and thanks to CELSI.
I'm sure in addition, in the research fund, I think you are already sowing the seeds for us to reap the rewards in the coming years by giving the JMAS Best Article Award, also recognizing the work of all the postgraduates for the thesis, and also all the people in the members, if they are writing a very good paper, at least the top five are going to be appreciated by an appreciable cash award also in the coming annual congress. I think all these things are what I call the long-term vision in mind. That is what very much important, because the day you plant the seed is not the day we all going to eat the fruit. But you very well know, I think that's what we all need to understand and execute. Your thoughts on all these research activities, where you got this inspiration from?
Okay, so this particular slide is basically what reflects the IAGS efforts. People who started IAGS never realized that it will grow so well, but they knew that they are going in the right direction, whether it was Professor Odwadia or Dr. B.K. Rao or Dr. J.B. Agarwal. And we are in that position now because what effort they have done. So I think as far as research is concerned, and you showed the picture of Dr. Ramesh Agarwala, if Professor Udwa, Professor Shikhande was my surgical mentor, Ramesh is my IAGS mentor. He brought me in IAGS. He motivated me to resume my activities in IAGS. And that is how I became active in IAGS once again. And as far as research is concerned, I think this is the way to go, because India has got everything. We have got highly talented surgeons. We have got very good hospitals. We have support staff. We have ICMR with dynamic ethical committee and other issues. We have funding available. The only thing missing is a research culture. And I thought, this is not something new. I was president of All India Association for Advancing Research in Obesity in 2007 to 2009. And I struggled to get a research started, and I knew what were the pitfalls. So when we came to start this, when I initiated this thought, I knew where not to go. And you remember probably the first meeting we had of the research committee, and there were many suggestions came, and I was very emphatic. No, this I'm not ready to accept. And that's how we made it very clear, because I knew what are the pitfalls in having an association starting a research activity. And I am glad with Ramesh and other Sandeep Agarwal and Dr. Kanagwal, we could quickly move it forward, and three research projects have taken off in a short period of 6 months, which is a sort of record for any association or even any surgeon to do that. I am sure research is going to define IAGS in times to come.
I fully agree with you, President. But in my opinion, maybe because of my personal involvement, your masterstroke I see is this last 6 months or so is the initiation of the online fellowship courses. Because when we had the COVID, when we are wondering what we are going to do with all our flagship programs like FAGS, EFAGS, all the subspecialty falls, you had an answer. You were able to conceptualize, coming with a belief we can do it, and able to achieve with the right virtual platform in a record time, how the countries were able to come out with a record time vaccine. This is the dose you are able to offer to all our people itching to learn in the virtual platform. This is a process, nicely said, not compromising on the quality, and because we already had the structure in place, we were able to apply the same formula in the online platform. Now we are on the step 5, and I'm sure step 6 is standing on the podium with all our virtual platform, you giving all the convocation to 300 plus people because of this venture you had. I'm sure we had a lot to say, but I'm sure the person to say about this commitment and all your commitment is what I call the Bhishma of IAGS, Professor Krishna Rao. Let us hear from him what he is to say.
Sir, Krishna Rao sir is in live, sir. You like to listen to him?
Wait a minute.
Hotel corridors and sofas and discussed for a long period of time his vision of IAGS and what he would like to do during his term of presidency. He already had the vision of having online courses, thus thereby allowing candidates to attend the course at their convenience, instead of coming all the way to a center, spending time and listening to the lectures by various faculty members. So the COVID had given him the unexpected opportunity to put the ideas that he had had about having an online courses for the IAGS. I should say that he has done an extremely appreciable and commendable job during the last 12 months. The very fact that our courses have extended beyond our Indian borders to neighboring countries like Bangladesh, Nepal, Sri Lanka, Maldives, and Pakistan shows that the quality and the content of our course is excellent, and people even across the Europe and states have joined these courses, and you have received a number of commendations on the course that has been conducted. All that is because of what Raman had in his mind even before the pandemic came in, of conducting online courses for our delegates. Moreover, he has a different opinion of how to go about to increase the membership, the academic content of the courses, and also to have this prime time whereby the members are brought in to understand and appreciate the leaders in the laparoscopic surgery, like Tamter Udwadia, Pradeep Chaube, and other senior members of our organization, as to how they have contributed in the early days of our IAGS. I think he deserves more than a formal appreciation. He has done an exceedingly excellent work to keep the flag of the IAGS flying high during this 12 months, and has earned the appreciation of each and every member of our society and also the senior members of our society.
I think Professor Krishna Rao has been my mentor and philosopher for many of the IAGS members. He, I call, is a walking constitution. What do you think of Professor Krishna Rao and his association with you in the last two or three decades, President? I'm sure he is also listening to you, and he is going to respond immediately as you finish your response.
So if you want to ask me, I will say he is my sounding board. Whenever I had a thought, I'll catch him wherever, you know. So as he mentioned, so many times after in a remote city in India, and we will sit outside a lift on those couches in a hotel, and we'll probably talk for 2 hours about IAGS, nothing else. We will discuss about constitution, we'll discuss about what I feel should be done or what he has in mind. And this would be a ongoing discussion to give it a shape. How do we take it forward from there? So I think a lot of it has been, and he's a man who is very, very upright. So when there was some doubt about election last year, he called me up and says, I know you, I might lose your friendship, but this is what I feel. And that is the that shows the depth of the person, because that shows that he is he knows what he's doing and he knows what is he going to lose because of being honest. So I think I have phenomenal respect of Professor B. Krishna Rao, and I think, as you rightly said, he's the Bhish Pitame of IAGS. He's the man who gives direction to whatever we do, and I'm so glad he was here and he spoke so good about what it is we had done. The online program, as you remember, I had suggested in Guwahati meeting, but that time nobody knew COVID is coming. And I didn't know this COVID is coming. I was doing it otherwise, and it was turned down by the executive committee. But as COVID came and the online program was immediately sanctioned by the emergency meeting, we could build it up, and you have been the architect of online program along with the platform that we are using. And now I know it's such an immense asset, because why I wanted online program was because I thought of surgeons in my hometown who never come to attend for fellowships. They are the ones who are nursing home owners, extremely busy, very competent. They want to do a fellowship program, but they cannot spend 3 days away from their hospital. So I thought if we have an online program, our reach or capacity to retrain those surgeons increases immensely. And this was before the COVID time. So I'm glad this has been accepted and has become probably a part, a norm of IAGS for times to come.
I think it is going to have a snowball effect. It is only going to go one direction. I am very sure about it. I am sure Professor Krishna Rao sir is going to unmute and he is going to give his input live with you now, President. Over to you, sir. Nice to see you today.
Thank you, Raman. All that I can say is that you have excelled as no other president has done the last 27 years. Because nobody expected in the period of this COVID that this sort of program and academic activity will be or would be possible, and we could extend our reach to the neighboring countries. You have done extremely well. I congratulate you, and I'm sure you will go down the history of IHS as one of the top presidents of the past. Or the present IAGS. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for comments. I think it's very well said, and I am sure all of us agree with every statement you made. I think Raman has somehow a good relationship with the Royal College of Edinburgh, for that matter. Even during the COVID, he was managed to go there to get his honorary fellowship. Then he remained as a royal ambassador, I call it, and brought this Indo-UK Surgicon, which we were longing to attend as an on-site, turned into an online program, thanks to him, along with the Royal College President, Mike Griffin. Over to you, Rama.
Another landmark achievement in your presidency was this Indo-UK Surgicon, which was the first international collaborative conference on the virtual platform. So everyone was excited, but as you calmed down, composed, and literally maneuvered everyone in clockwise or clock run precision. And thanks to Dr. Pamanindran and all and their team, we have a wonderful, unforgettable memories across. And he could bring all the stalwarts of minimum access surgery, people like my Dr. Nathan Jindal, President FSS, and Professor Sir Alfred Kushari. And not to tell you, even your gift to everyone, everyone cherished it. And even the next generation, as you can see, the grandson of our Dr. John Dhanakumar treasured it. So you made everyone happy, sir.
You were happy moments of conceptualizing and conducting and executing this exciting program, Raman.
So I had suggested this program to President Saindev during his term. But since it could not take place at that time, we decided to hold it in Edinburgh. And we were all set. I mean, many people had even booked their tickets. But then we did it online because of COVID. And I'm so glad that the team of the organizing team, which included Pavninder, Anubhav, Deep, yourself, and many more, you know, executed it to perfection. So I think all this credit that is being given to me is not actually my credit. It's entirely teamwork. And as a surgeon, we all know that the most important thing the surgeon does is delegate responsibilities, then have accountability and have transparency. So this is what I did. I gave responsibility to people and I held them accountable. I was, as you said, I have been after them to make sure that the work gets executed. I hope I have not stepped on anybody's toes or I have not been being very rough with anybody. But if it is, I'm really sorry. But at the end, the product was good. People liked it, especially the scientific program. And this is what I see as the future of scientific commitment in the country, that our associations, not only IAGS, need to take up and move forward. That the scientific content of every conference has to gradually improve to a certain level that people should say that our conferences are better scientifically than the best in the world. And I think that's possible.
As you rightly said, I think with all our collective efforts, any association for that matter, we are already 8,000 plus active members. I think we need to understand the secrets of success is the inclusiveness, our contribution. I'm going to show you the two clips from our two great personalities of our AGS, the father of the laparoscopy, Professor Udvadia, and the father of the flexible endoscopy, Krishna Rao, telling how an association has to function and grow. Let us go to their places.
The success of a large body, academic body, I would view an organization like an extended family, even if it's thousands of people. And in a family, you have love, fellowship, and understanding. And I think if an association, every member, has this approach to the association, this association can only grow with strength, with harmony, and with vigor. The other thing is that, apart from that, we also need total and transparent honesty and integrity, especially amongst all office bearers. For example, you say that you have regard for Krishna Rao. I have greater regard for him. And you will appreciate that he was the second president of our association. Now, if Krishna Rao says something, not one member of the association will query. His integrity is stamped on whatever he says. The second thing about an association is that this is a national association. This is not an association of a part of the country or a state or our area, it is a national association. And we must look upon it with that fervent, patriotic enthusiasm that this is the Indian Association of IAGS. And according to me, there are two aspects to the growth of an association. One is the membership number, which is very important. And we have no question about how we have been growing. And the second is quality. And that is also a way we have always been paying great attention to, the quality of the association. In terms of leadership, I think just as an association is a family, the leader is the father of the family. He should look upon all people as equal. Here in a family, there'll be always multiple views. He should listen to all and go by concurrence and not by any diktat, but by concurrence and approval of everybody. And this is what has been happening throughout these 30 odd years that the association has been functioning. And I think, as I've always said, our leadership has never been in doubt. I've always said that each president has done better than his predecessor. It's a sequence of events. Every president has been better than the previous. And if this continues, there's no stopping the strength and growth of IAGS.
An association is meant for its members. As long as the leaders in this association, of any association, keep this in mind and take away their personal input into the organization for their self, then the organization will thrive. You will notice that the IAGS has been handed on from our founder president down the ages to many presidents, many committee members, many EC members, and also lecturers in various IAGS courses, not only in laparoscopy, hernia, obesity, robotic surgery, etc., that the baton has been handed down to younger people to carry on the good work that has been started 2 years ago. So that is the one will enthuse the younger surgeons that they too have an opportunity to come and be a lecturer, a teacher, and thereby pass on their knowledge to the youngsters. One person has not stayed in a position in our association for more than the allotted time by the Constitution. And that, I think, is the most important thing for the progress of an association. And lastly, there has been no politics in our IAGS. And that will completely take our organization to much greater heights as it has done over the years. Each member of the association should consider himself to be part of the IAGS and contribute to its well-being and growth. Unless the member considers that he is part and parcel of this large organization, the organization will not flourish. Next, they should contribute to the IAGS academically and should be a pillar to take over from the present generation who are conducting the IAGS. I think that would be the most important thing that the younger people should understand, that they are responsible for the continuity and growth of this organization.
I think there are lots of grains of truth in whatever they both of them said. I think all of us are now waiting to hear, what do you think is an essential thing for an association to grow, President? Having spent 12 months in this chair as a president, I'm sure you have a lot learned. You are going to give a piece of advice to all of us waiting to hear from you.
Sorry. So, Ishwar, I am not the one who gives advices. I always believe that self-transformation is world transformation. There are more problems happening in the world because people try to improve others. All that we have to do is that we have to improve ourselves. And whatever I have done in last 1 year, I have done it for my own happiness. Whatever I wanted to do, I have done with the idea that if I am happy about certain activities, it is going to benefit the association. So my way of working is that I want to do what I feel is good for the association and what I feel is right. And generally, there is no conflict. So I think the only way is that every successive leader, and I have great burden on my shoulder when I have a founder president and trustees leaders like Dr. N.G. Bhatt, Dr. Venkatesh, Jonathan Kumar, and Dr. Abhay Dalvi, all those people, Suresh Deshpande, all those people who have been past presidents, they are all big leaders in laparoscopic surgery, watching over every activity that you do. So the only way forward is to stay straight on the course and to do whatever is right. And I think the association will automatically grow. There is nothing much to be done because we have a collective wisdom of about 48 members in the executive committee. As Professor Udwadia is saying, if you listen to everybody's opinion, automatically you have a solution. When you try to dictate, when you have something in your mind which you want to dictate, then there is a conflict. But when you have a collective wisdom, it is always right. So a leader is one who is secure in his mind and who is ready to listen to others and then only take a decision. So I think this is the way forward for the association.
Thank you. I am sure you have been a listening leader, and we are very, very fortunate to have you, President. I think things are getting better even from the COVID front. I am sure our incoming President Sunil is already relaxing, getting to his action in the coming weeks, if not days. And I think we are all ready for the new normal life. And you're also going to have a relaxing time. Already you have been walking in the Juhu Beach. I am sure you lost weight internationally with your diet prescribed by Madhu. And I'm sure with the vaccine every one of us are having, I'm sure India is going to get better and win this COVID. And I'm going to leap forward to 2021 with a positive note. And I am sure till that time we need to stay safe. And I'm sure you have one job in your hand yet to be performed, of course, as a Congress President of IHS 2021, where I also have a part of the responsibility on my shoulder with LP Thangaveli as a chairman. Your thoughts, how you want to execute, what do you expect from us?
Sir Ishwar, a conference is a showcase of the work of the people. So besides the routine lectures and debates and those kind of things, dinners and talks, I think gradually Indian conferences should center stage the free papers. And as you know, I have been very emphatic that free papers should gradually get the most important part of the conference, not in a corner room, not the last activity of the day or first activity of the day. Any international conference you go, we get plenary, which includes free papers. I have presented free paper in our ASMBS at 11 o'clock in the morning, which is the prime time. So I think we must differentiate, and I'm talking to the members of the association, we must differentiate between CMEs and training programs and conference. Conference is where a surgeon from Mathura or a surgeon from Agra or a surgeon from any city in Maharashtra can come and show what they have been doing and discuss it with the experts. This is where we must have focus. And if we cannot do it, we are failing, because this is what I realized, because people say that, you know, this will upset other people politically. No, forget the politics. We are here because of academics. And we have to set a benchmark. We have to be the role model to show the way, because 10 years down the line, next generation will ask why you did not do it the right way. So I think, I believe Coimbatore is shaping out very well. I don't need to give any advice to you. I am in it on a daily basis, as we have a meeting almost daily about it. I know this will be probably one of the best meetings that IHS has ever hosted, because you are there as organizing secretary, Dr. Thangaveli are there as the organizing chairman, and the treasurer. I think this will come out very well, because the scientific program is strong and local organizing team is going to take care of the things. And IHS has been hosting very good conferences, and this will be one step forward from there.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you for your faith and confidence. I'm sure we'll have a great Congress in the coming months. I invite all the members and all the viewers to come and to Coimbatore to experience the Kongu hospitality on May 6th to 9th. I think it is going to be a memorable academic delight for every one of us. And coming to the final few minutes with you, President, I think the time is a killer here. I think we had a chat with the family and friends. They are important. Association, yes, we have been spending day in, day out for the growth of our association. But what distinguishes a surgeon is his own surgical practice. I think every day, unless we see patients, we start operating or do endoscopy, we don't feel success. So there are some success formula for a surgical practice that is a satisfied customer. I'm sure you had a great relationship with your patients. There are a lot of patients, I was talking to them. Every one of them, they said you are easily approachable and you are so cordial, understanding their anguish. I mean, they are able to answer every small. It may be a very simple thing for you, but still you are able to go and explain to them every small details to keep them on extreme comfort. That is a thing. for just a taste of one thing, I'm going to take you to one of your patients. Let us listen. From there, we'll know how good you are as a passionate, compassionate doctor.
Hello, I am Dr. Raman Goyal's patient since 2008, which is, well, almost more than 12 years now. And Dr. Raman Goyal is super awesome in his surgical skills. We all already know that. The whole world knows that. In addition to his medical competencies, I think what sets him apart from all other doctors and what really inspires all his patients is Dr. Raman Goyal's intent and actions of always being reachable for his patients. We have all troubled him at odd hours, on unearthly hours, and he has always diverted to WhatsApp messages. He has picked up phone calls. He has replied to SMSs. So he's always there for his patients. I think that's what is distinctly positive about him. And Dr. Raman Goyal ensures that the patients never feel left out all on their own. We are very active on support group meetings that he and his team organizes. And it's so reassuring to know that Dr. Raman Goyal is literally a phone call away, even after 12 years of my surgery. I think that's very, very special about him, that creates that kind of respect and admiration that all his patients have for Dr. Goyal. Another thing about Dr. Goyal is that he sets the right example by being fit and inspires all of us for weight loss goals. And he's a role model because of the way he has maintained good health and physical well-being. I thank Dr. Raman Goyal for being what he is. Thank you.
I think every patient like her is going to be an ambassador for anybody, for that matter, for an excellent, successful practice. I'm sure when a budding surgeon, they want an advice, what our founder president also said, what a successful practice means. I asked him this question. He answered in a minute. This is what I think is a nice practice.
I would say that think of your patient as your relative and treat your patient as though they are your relative, with not only technical skill, but with human approach and kindness. And always remember that a clean practice is the greatest reward a surgeon can give himself.
I think apart from your ability, the skill level, I think it is availability, your affability, and of course, cost effectiveness, it all matters. And that's what I thought. I'm sure Professor Krishnarao is right with us. Before I go to you, President, let us ask the secret formula for Krishnarao. I think people from all the world, I think they were thronging his place to learn the endoscopy. I'm sure when he had those days or the golden moments when he was there in Chennai, giving us all the opportunity to form. I think Govindaraj, myself, we were very, very fondly remember those days where when he was able to teach the endoscopy and have thousands of patients, gratified patients. Over to you, BKR sir, your secret formula for success for any practitioner, surgeon for that matter. What do you say in few words, please?
I think the most important thing is you must infuse confidence in your patient that what you are advising him is the correct treatment for him. He would have already gone to two or three other doctors, got a different opinion, and then come to you for a final opinion. So whatever you say will become a golden decision for him to undertake. I also remember that I have been training a number of doctors from all over India and the surrounding countries in endoscopic procedures. One of my seniors asked me, Krishnarao, if you're teaching so many, you will not get any patients. On the contrary, when my persons, doctors who have got trained, have problems, they refer the patients back to me. And hence, I come to deal with the difficult and problematic cases. Next important thing with the patient is the confidence he derives from being referred by a person who has undergone treatment under me and recommends that he goes to me for a final opinion. I think that matters a lot, because a word from a cured patient recommending you to another patient is the most important thing that you can expect in your private practice.
Thank you, sir. President, would you like to give your insight into this secrets of success in surgical practice?
So, Ishwar, I have been speaking on this in many forums in Mumbai on successful practice. And I think the bottom line is your competence. So there is no way that a surgeon can become successful if he's not competent. And competence comes with time. And second thing is, never be in a hurry. As Dr. Shikhande was saying, as you were also saying, every dog has his day and every dog also has his day. So if you wait out, I was going through Dr. Palani Velu's biography for an interview a few days back, and I realized he started his surgical career at 33 years of age. So if you wait out, automatically a time will come when your seniors whom trained you are not there and you are there to take charge. And then obviously all those A's that you mentioned, availability, affability, they are there. But I think the biggest teacher is the patient. I love to interact with my patients. My patients teach me more than what I have learned in my medical college. Because I love their knowledge from Google. People say that, you keep your Google knowledge outside the consulting room. I invite that inside. Because, if a well-informed patient is a better patient than ill-informed patient. And they might have some myths, they may have misconceptions, and that is our job to clarify. So my interaction with patient is, and again, I always quote my mentor, Dr. Shikhande. He says, Raman, you should be a doctor with ears like that, those of Ganpati. A doctor should have like big ears so that you can hear what they are saying. And I think that is very important, because in the history taking itself, we know 90% of the problems. And I think I owe my success. So if I say 10% to my teachers, 90% to my patients. And I am very close, as Dr. Gauri Joshi was saying, I am very close to my patients. I know, I attend their weddings, I attend their children's weddings, and I am like, they are like my family members and I am their family member. It may sound a little odd to the professional approach, the way it is taught in Western world, but come on, we live in India. We are different and we should be different. And I think this is the way to look ahead for surgical practice in India.
Thank you. Thank you, President. I think before I go for the last minute of my talk, I wanted Kanagwal to come to the screen and want to share his views. And also, if anything in the chat box or anybody want to contribute or express, please be free to express yourself, Kanagwal. Then I'll conclude in the final 1 minute. Thank you to you.
I think there are a few questions are there in the chat box. But I think one most relevant thing is someone has asked the president, could you please share your experience? You did tell about a little bit about loss of practice after the COVID era. And I'm sure surgeons across either in their practice or as a hospital or nursing home owners or a part of the corporate team have definitely suffered both on their personal grounds and financial grounds and the professional grounds. How did you manage and what is your experience on managing practice during the COVID pandemic, President?
So I think that's a very relevant question, especially to a bariatric surgeon who does nothing else except bariatric surgery for last, from 2011, 10 years now. So for me, it was a complete cessation of practice for first 4 months till July. And from July also, it's a very, very small practice. So I think the people who got affected most were those who are doing very exclusive practice, like transplant surgeons, like bariatric surgeons. A general surgeon continued to get emergency calls. People who got affected most were the hospital owners, nursing home owners. So I think this is a God's way of averaging out the large profits that or last income or large benefits that you had as an specialist and got averaged out. I made sure that none of my team member leaves, none of my personal staff member leaves during this COVID. So we supported everybody and we retained everybody with me. And I think we need to accept this with grace. And the turnaround time is almost there. So I know it's very difficult to tell somebody who has lost a lot of money or a lot of practice during this time, but there is no other way out. This is once in a lifetime or once in two or three lifetimes a pandemic like this hits. And we need to accept it as a God's will. And we learn to live with the loss of practice.
Thank you. Can I have well?
I have two questions to be completed, Ishwar.
Yeah.
Number one, Raman sir, like you had the blessings of all the seniors guiding you in the IAGS, as you rightly mentioned. And you also picked up many new faces like me, Anubhav. So many young faces were part of your team. And you ensured we had our space, we had our thoughts listened. And I would like to hear from you as a mentor or a well-wisher. People, youngsters, how they have to accept their next generation doctors into their leadership qualities, pull along in their path of the career, or allow them to go on their own career. In fact, I distinctly remembered the word you uttered about Professor Srikande. Dr. Goyal, your time has come. The time of residency is over and the time of professorship has come. That's the grace of Professor Srikande. And I could also see the same wisdom with you. Can you briefly tell what are the qualities as young surgeons like us should emulate when we train our next generation?
So I think training is an important component of a surgeon's life. Because we got trained by the best, we should train the next generation to become the best. And that involves a very close interaction with those people. Training them, retaining them with you, and retaining the better ones with you so that they remain as a part of team. It makes no sense to lose out on a well-trained assistant and retain them. And I have learned it from Professor Pradeep Chaubey and Professor Bansali from Mumbai and many other people like Dr. Palani Velu. And this is very important that you retain them, understand their aspirations, and explain to them that when they work as a team, it always helps bring the best out of the whole situation. Everybody's time comes. And I think there is no magic formula. It is between you and the trainee, a confidence that you are not hiding anything and you are onboarding him gradually. Even in corporate world, this term onboarding goes on for 1 year or 2 years. So here also, you are onboarding a person for 5 years or 10 years. But I think 10 years is a great time that the person becomes a senior consultant in your unit. So somewhere around 5 years, he becomes a consultant. And in about 10 years, he should be ready to replace you as the person. But this is what you must foresee and you must prepare gradually to accommodate him as your equal in the team. And giving respect to his opinions, that is so important at every stage in the operation theater when he gives opines on something, even if he's too young or even if it's something very illogical, at least listen to him and then explain why you want to follow or why you don't want to follow something. So I think this is the way to look forward for the team.
I think, Kanagavel, the reality of the life is today's training is going to be tomorrow's trainers. I think it is our moral obligation.
Absolutely.
Need to train for the future. I think they are going to, if I'm going to have appendicitis, I'm going to have operation done by my juniors. So you train them well, I'm sure you are in safe hands. I think it may be a little personal. I think it's going to be the way, because whatever we got, we need to give back to the country, give back to the society. I think that's the way, I think the creation has been done. I think that is a philosophical way of looking. That's the way I see it anyhow. And over to you, Kanagavel.
Dr. Raman, maybe it's a little personal. As a president, many times. We know that sometimes we were not able to execute to your aspirational levels or the levels you tried to push us. I've always sensed a bit of anger in your thought, not on your face. How do you keep calm and composed?
Okay, so I think I must have antagonized few people, including Dr. Kanagwal.
Never, sir. Never in that context. But that is the way I have appreciated you, how you keep composed, but still continue to trust the relationship and value the relationship. That's the most important learning I've ever heard from any of my mentor in my life.
So, Kanagwal, one thing I learned during my presidentship, I have never apologized to somebody publicly so many times as I have done during last 1 year. I have probably not apologized to you yet. I should be doing that. But I have done that because it is, and many times I was right. I was right and the other person was wrong. But still, in the interest of getting the work done for the association, I publicly apologized. And I think not because I'm a leader, but it's important for a person who is leading a family. You know, it's like being a father in a family, and you have a grown-up children around you. We know all of us have grown-up children. How many times the father knows that he's right, but is still, if the son or the daughter insists on something, you say, okay, yes, you are right, I go ahead with you. So that is a way of accepting their view and going ahead. So I'm aware what I want and how I want, because as a person, the center of the thing, I am getting inputs from 5 or 6 people, and I need to take a decision to get it done in a time. And that is why sometimes you feel that impatience in my thoughts, but that's not personal. If Kanagwal, that has always been for the system.
100%, sir. I've never taken definitely personal. I'm sure I'm not going to do that in future as well. We look forward for your continued mentoring and guidance wherever we need leadership and any clarifications or guidance from our side. One last question. I've been asking this to all the legends, and I'm sure you are one too from our side. Dreams. Dr. Ishwar was telling, you are the first president who had a very long planning, first easy meeting, where you outlined in detail and you fixed up the responsibility and fixed up the team and delegated. Almost you had the full year calendar on. It's so much of commitment, and the entire pathway took in a different way. So you had to change the track. If you can list out 1, 2, 3, you dreamt, you planned, or you dreamt and you could not achieve. What are those 3 things we have not achieved in your presidency?
Oh, wow. That's a difficult one. So I think what I started with, I could achieve almost 95% of it. Because we did something on the spur of moment when COVID came, and we modified it together. What we couldn't achieve was probably involvement of corporates more closely with the association. I have seen how interaction between corporates work more efficiently for delivery, not for finances, for improving the quality of care. The second thing that I feel pained, and it's not about this association, this is about overall, that people have started thinking, not only acting, started thinking in a way that suits the masters of the association. So if somebody who is very popular posts something in a social group, there are 100 people who will say thumbs up for something very silly or very basic. While if somebody who has posted something very relevant, like a very intellectual study, people would not even bother because that person is not politically very strong. I think this is a very awkward situation in which intellectuals are going. As people who are well-read professionals, we should learn to appreciate the right, whether it comes from Mr. A or B or R or C, and B, if you don't want to criticize, remain quiet, but at least do not appreciate something which doesn't discern the merit to show a thumbs up. So I think it's not a question of what I achieved. I'm a very small spoke in a wheel of IAGS. I do not have a legacy to leave. I believe I am going to be followed by a very capable successor, a dynamic Sunil Popat, who is taking over in 5 days' time. I have great faith in the succession of people because I see so many people coming ahead. So I am a satisfied man. I'm a happy man. And I don't want to now at this end time count anything that has been left out. So thank you so much, Kanavil.
And on behalf of all of us, young ones and colleagues, we seek your blessings as a fatherly figure, and we seek your guidance all through, sir. Thank you, Mr. President. And we now over to Dr. Ishwar for concluding remarks, please.
Thank you, Kanavil. I think we need to wish on behalf of our EC, the whole people waiting here, I think in their own home, wish you both, you and your family, very happy, healthy, peaceful life. I think we had a very action-packed 12 months. Thanks for that, President.
We know that every action should become a habit, and a habit builds a character, and the character defines the nation.
I think you are all sure, we are all sure that you are destined to be a master and a leader in the field of minimal access surgery. We request you, and please continue to inspire us. And I think we had a great day today with Professor Udvadia and Krishna Rao sir, and your mentor Srikanthi, and also David across from Singapore, and all your family here, to have an insight in your family life and association growth, and also the success formula for a successful surgical practice. We had a great day. Thank you, Prime Time. Thank you, Kanagavel, for the last 12 months. I think it is going to be a blockbuster every time. And Doc Pluses for your seamless transmission the whole every time. And thank you. And I think we are very proud as an IAGS fellow, and also very proud as an Indian. Thank you, Jai Hind. Bye-bye now.
Thank you,
Dr. Ishwar. Thank you, President.
Kanagavel, thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. And for the friends who are online on Facebook, DocPlexus or YouTube, I've been informed by the incoming president that he would like to continue the IAGS prime time. But of course, he has his own way to do, and he has advised me to wait for further instructions and advice regarding the plan and the format. So I do expect more advice and instructions from the incoming president. So I'm sure we are continuing the IAGS prime time. After the EC meeting, I think we will come afresh with the newer plans of the incoming president, and we will work as per his instructions. Thank you, one and all. Thank you, President. Thank you, Krishna Rao sir. Thank you, Ishwar sir. And thank you, Rama ma'am. And thank you, Doc Plexus. It has been an amazing journey all through. Doc Plexus also had changing phases, but then every incomer is trying to outperform the earlier person. So we are at comfort zone. Thank you, team Doc Plexus. And we wish all the participants on various platforms a good night and a happy weekend. Good night.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.